Welcome to Destination Sainthood. This is your journey with and to the great cloud of witnesses on WCAT Radio. I'm your host, Annabelle Moseley. I'm a poet, author, and professor of theology, and this is the show reminding us of Pope St. John Paul II's call to become a saint and do so quickly. You'll find hope and inspiration through discussions of our Catholic saints in heaven and stories of some unfinished saints on this side of heaven. Join us as we work, hope, and pray to be in that number when the saints go marching in. God's beloved, welcome to Destination Sainthood, where we remember the destination we're humbly working and praying for. Do not be afraid to become the saints of the new millennium, said Pope St. John Paul II. And so, we labor with those words in our hearts. On this episode of Destination Sainthood, we'll celebrate Thanksgiving through our gratitude for the examples of the saints, the Most Holy Eucharist, which means Thanksgiving, and curated songs and prayers. Let's begin with a song by Chris Tomlin. Thank you, God.
What can I give to you? What can I offer to a king for all the love you've shown, for all your mercy over me? I called your name, you heard my cry. Of salvation, my hope is built on nothing less. Morning by morning, how great is your faithfulness! I called your name, you heard my cry. Your life upon the cross, you suffered. soul is free. Thank you, God, for saving me.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God, for saving me.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God, for saving me.
We are honored to have Father Bob Smith with us on the show today. Father Bob is pastor of St. Hugh of Lincoln Roman Catholic Church in Huntington, New York. He'll be speaking about his vocation, his pilgrimage of faith, his spiritual influences and favorite saints. He's such a perfect guest for this special Thanksgiving episode. Father Bob, would you grace us with a prayer to start this episode?
Oh, I'd be honored. Almighty and all-loving God, we know that you, in your great grace, call us to our destiny of sanctity. We bless you and praise you for that gift. And we know that you give us companions on that journey, the great cloud of witnesses that surround us and that cheer us onward. And so we bless you for calling us forward into lives of holiness. We ask you to be with us as we continue that journey. Help us that we may give you glory by the living of our lives. All of this we ask through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Thank you so much for joining us, Father Bob. We really feel very blessed here on Destination Sainthood to have you with us today.
Oh, and thank you, Annabelle, for the great privilege. It's a delight to be here, and I'm looking forward to our conversation.
Oh, thanks so much. Well, I would love to ask you right off the bat if you would be so kind as to share any part of your vocation story. So in other words, how did you become aware of your vocation? Or what's the most profound or wonderful or meaningful element of your vocation for you?
Yeah, awareness of my vocation, that's a question I've asked myself many, many times. I think it was an awareness that dawned suddenly in one way, but very, very gradually in another.
Oh, wow.
So if I look back, I realized that it was probably something that was beginning to move around in my heart and spirit very early on in my life. But my more sudden awareness would have been at the time that I was preparing to go to high school, and I had the option to go to a local Catholic high school that was a prep seminary where young men who were thinking about it. So that sort of triggered me thinking about it specifically. But if I look back, I think the seeds of that were already sown in my family life. And largely, as I think about it backward, largely through my grandmother, my mother's mother, with whom my family lived. We lived with my grandparents for several years.
Wow,
so I had
special.
Very daily contact with her, and just watching her own holiness, not in any overt way, although she was certainly a woman of prayer. I think those are the things that began to seed my vocation. And then, as I mentioned, when it was time for high school, it sort of came to me more clearly or more suddenly.
Wow. That's beautiful. It's funny. I would love to hear it. One of the questions I actually had prepared to ask you was, what person in your life was instrumental in guiding you in faith? So maybe if you'd be so kind as to just tell us a bit more about this wonderful grandmother of yours.
She was, as I mentioned, a woman of great prayer. Her heritage was Italian.
Yeah.
And so she was devoted to many of the devotions that had come to her in her early childhood. So there were images of the Blessed Mother, images of Jesus, images of various saints in her part of the home.
Aww.
And that was always something that drew me in, and to see her relying upon them as her friends, her confidants, was something that spoke very strongly to me. As I'm saying all of this, I certainly don't mean to exclude the other members of my family, my grandfather.
Sure.
And my mother and father. All of the adults that surrounded me in my early life were people of faith in different degrees. But as I think back a bit, I think about my grandmother predominantly in that way. I think in that way she was certainly a great part of the formation of my faith.
Wow. It sounds like she really lived it.
She did indeed, yes.
Yeah, and it almost sounds like it was just like she breathed it, like without even having to draw attention to it, just it was who she was.
That's a very good way of describing it.
Wow. So she lived a kind of vocation too.
Yes, she did.
Some sort of, you know, that's beautiful.
Yeah.
That's beautiful. So who would you say would be your favorite saint, or if you have more than one?
I do have more than one. So I'll reach back first to the earliest parts of our Catholic history and talk about Saints Perpetua and Felicity.
Wow.
Who somewhere along the line, I'm sorry that I can't pinpoint where, but the story of their lives caught my attention. And what caught my attention most, I think, is the fact that though they were of different classes in ancient Rome, they became sisters in Christ. And so their devotion to one another, they were martyred together. Their devotion to one another struck me as a very powerful sign of something that St. Paul says, that in Christ there is no Jew or Greek or a slave or free or male or female, that we are all one in the body of Christ. And so I've always thought about that and taken great inspiration, and I found it also challenging to, with their intercession, to live in the same way, to see all around me as my brothers and sisters in Christ. So there's Perpetua and Felicity. St. Francis, of course, for so many, and I happily include myself in holding St. Francis as one of my favorites for his honesty, his recognizing what was unfolding in his own life, even at cost to him, leaving his family and devoting himself to what he felt God was calling him to do.
Yeah.
His love of those around him, his love of those who are in need, his love of creation, all of those things speak very strongly to me. So Francis would certainly be strong on my list. And then in my recent years, this has to do with the journey of my own life. In my recent years, I find myself drawn to and thinking about and appreciating the intercession and accompaniment of St. Oscar Romero. For his courage in holding fast to his faith, even to the point of his martyrdom, and the connection. So I presently have the privilege of serving in a parish community that, as you know, Annabelle, is a parish community that would embrace both those of American heritage and those who come from other places, predominantly Central and South America, and many from El Salvador. So I find myself drawn to and inspired by and strengthened by the accompaniment of Romero.
That's wonderful. What a, you know, as you're speaking, I had this image in my mind. I'm thinking of some of the great art, some of the great Renaissance art, where there'd be depicted, or even the work of Fra Angelico, where there'd be depicted a sacred conversation, a sacra conversazione in paint, and they'd have different saints from different time periods.
Yes, that's wonderful.
All in the same painting.
Yes.
And I'm picturing a painting of you with Saints Perpetua and Felicity and St. Francis and St. Oscar Romero. And it really creates a beautiful story for your own life and your own vocation. I'm so very moved as you're talking about your grandmother. It's amazing how influential my own grandma was in my faith. And I'm thinking about actually my grandpa when I was little. I remember one day I came in, I was living with them for a while, and he was shining his shoes, and he was very quiet. And after he shined his shoes, he was still sitting in the same chair. And I said, "Grandpapa, what are you doing? What are you doing?" He says, "I'm praying. This is the time I pray every night, and I'm talking with Our Lady. And if you ever need anything, go to Our Lady. She'll always be there for you." I was 6 years old. There was something about his words and the way he said them, and the way he was just shining his shoes, but praying while he did that simple act, that made this big impression on me that we're people of prayer and we're meant to pray all times and in all ways. Do you remember any moments with her? She just sounds like such an amazing woman. Anything that you remember her saying to you, or just little things she did in a prayerful way?
Oh, I do, definitely, Annabelle. So what that brings back to my memory is what I would think of as a regular practice of hers. So one of the images that she had in her household was a statue of the Sacred Heart. And wow. I would frequently enough find her in prayer there. And she would say to me, it's so important to think about Jesus and the Sacred Heart because it reminds us of God's great love for us and also the love that we must share always with other people.
Wow.
And she'd point out to me that the heart was wounded, but that's okay, mm-hmm. she said, not wounded unto death. Those are my words. She probably said it much more eloquently and beautifully in a simple way.
Yeah.
But and she would remind me that no, that heart, even though wounded, is even stronger in having been wounded for our sake. So, yeah, things of that kind that she would say. All of that, that's a condensed version of things she probably said to me over the course of a long period of time.
Right.
But thank you so much for bringing back that memory to me, yeah.
Thank you. I can really see how she would influence you because as you're talking about her, I have a very vivid image of the strong impression she made on you. It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much for sharing that with us. And especially in the life of someone who would grow up to become a priest, how proud she must be of you. Really.
I hope she is, yes.
Father Bob, would you mind sharing your grandmother's name?
Oh, I'm happy to, Annabelle. Her name was and is,
yes,
Serafina.
So
it strikes
name.
Me here in this moment as we're talking about it, it strikes me that that has a close association with, as we speak of the angels, the cherubim and the seraphim. So Serafina, my grandmother, yes, one of the angels.
Oh, that's so beautiful. So I have a question for you. Which saint would you most like to have dinner with and why?
Yes. I think I might most like to have dinner with St. John the 23rd.
Wow.
First to hear firsthand his own thoughts and experiences of a life that was extraordinarily interesting, I think, at the ways in which he served the church and all of the challenges that he met in that service. And so I'd love to hear that. I think of St. John the 23rd as being a key figure in the life of the church, the life of the contemporary church, and of course in the fact that he drew the church together in the Second Vatican Council. So I'd love to hear his thoughts about that, both the thoughts that he had prior to the council,
right,
and the thoughts that he has now looking down upon us as we journey into the life of the council, we might say. And thirdly, everything I've ever read about St. John the 23rd indicates that he had a really good sense of humor. So I think I'd enjoy
that would be a fun dinner.
Sharing dinner with him in that regard as well.
Oh, that's great. That's great. Now, looking back, we talked a little bit about your childhood. Which saint do you think you would most like to have had as a childhood friend, someone back in childhood to know?
Yeah, I'm so grateful for that question. It gave me a chance to think about that. And I think I would have liked to have as a friend St. Philip Neri.
Wow.
Not that I knew anything about him when I was a kid.
Sure.
But as I've learned about him in various ways, his ability to engage people in conversation about their faith life, being able to jump right into conversations as far as I've learned about him and have no fear about that, although perhaps he did have fear, but yet was able to do it and engage people on a deep level.
Right.
I was a very shy kid.
Aww,
so I think to myself, oh, Philip would have been a good help to me. Maybe he was. Sometimes I think it's interesting to me that having been relatively shy when I was a kid, I now find myself in a way of life where I'm talking to a lot of people all the time and in public situations very frequently. So I think, Philip, I think I would have enjoyed having that conversation with him. And
I wonder if that early shyness is a gift to you in the way that perhaps you'll notice the person in the crowd when you're ministering who isn't as easily drawn out.
Yes, I think I probably do have that awareness
that's so nice.
Based on my own history, yes.
Yeah. Now, which saint would you like to take a class from?
It'd be a toss-up between, and I'm sure no one will be surprised, a toss-up between the great Augustine and the great Thomas Aquinas.
Oh, perfect picks.
Or maybe I'd like to like see them just sit there and duke it out and learn from their own interactions with one another. But either of them, surely I'd be so fortunate to learn a great deal from either of them, as I hope I have in reading and studying their work.
You spoke so eloquently of the devotion of your grandmother to the Sacred Heart and how she really lived that devotion, even teaching her little grandson about our call to follow that Sacred Heart's teachings. What devotion or devotions have had the most meaning for you in your life?
I've found myself more and more immersed in the praying of the Liturgy of the Hours. So that devotion of morning prayer and evening prayer, I wish I could say I achieve them, morning prayer and evening prayer, as much as I would like.
It's hard for a busy pastor, too.
It's a challenge. But I do love the praying of the hours and the praying of the psalms that come with the hours. That has been a great source of strength for me in my faith journey. So that devotion is very important to me. Also, certainly the praying of the rosary, which I think I would probably link back to my grandmother. She was she prayed the rosary daily, if not more than once a day.
Wow.
And though for a long part in my life, it wasn't a devotion that engaged me.
Right.
I've found that in my in more recent years, 10, 12, 15 years now, it's a devotion that I find very nourishing and very strengthening. So so those, and then certainly I find times a prayer before the Blessed Sacrament in holy hours or times when the community gathers for benediction and exposition of the sacrament, those I find very powerful times of devotional prayer as well.
You're also very musical, aren't you? You have a great love of music.
Oh, I do. Yes, I do.
So would you say, too, also in song? And certainly
yes.
We've all noticed that in your parish, that you know, when it's time to sing, you really seem to be very moved by that, as we all are. I think we have a great music ministry in our parish. We're very lucky.
Yes, right. We are very blessed. And thank you for mentioning it that way. I don't think I would have thought of that
as being
a devotional practice, but as soon as you say it, of course.
Well, what it is that your parish is moved by that. It's something that, you know, and I'll tell you that now, but your parishioners will say, wow, Father Bob, he brings music. He really, you bring it more, I think, for all of us with your clear joy in it.
As
not just a song, but really as worship. What was it, St. Augustine? I was just reading this. Music is prayer prayed twice?
Yes.
Or doubly?
Well, the one who sings prays twice,
yes,
right? I've seen
the
it in that way, too.
Prays twice.
Yes.
Well, we feel that you do that for sure. I know with my own grandmother, the Anima Christi really was her prayer. And watching her in her life and even in her death, leaning on the Anima Christi, it became a prayer important to me. And I realize it's something that's shaped my faith and but when I say it, I've come to realize it's also a connection to her. That isn't it wonderful that something that was important to my grandmother's faith is now important to mine? So I just imagine how your grandmother prayed the rosary with so much love, and now that's a devotion important to you. It's also a bond to her.
Absolutely. Every time I pray the rosary, I certainly think about my grandmother, because I do think that my own being drawn in that direction is largely due to her, and perhaps through her intercession, and certainly then the great love that I've felt from my grandmother, to be sure, my own mother, and then Mary, the mother of the Lord, our mother too. So the maternal, the power of that maternal love in my own life as I've experienced it. Yes.
Well, it's wonderful, isn't it, to notice the saintly moments or the saintly qualities of people we've known. One of the things we've spoken about before on Destination Sainthood is that anyone who makes it to heaven is a saint. So we have all these famous saints, but we also have those saints that are in heaven, some of whom we knew. And it's wonderful when we can remember that it's the call of each of us to, with God's grace, to eventually become a saint ourselves, to see people we knew who had saintly moments and be inspired by that.
Absolutely.
So what childhood experience would you say, or experiences, had most profoundly shaped you as a person of faith?
As I think about that, Annabelle, I think about it in terms of the love that my parents showered upon me in so very many ways. Again, I don't think I was aware of it, although I hope I was as far as I could be as a child. But as I look back, I realize how blessed I was, and still am. I'm happy to say my parents are still living. How blessed I was and am by these two wonderful people, saintly in their very many ways, who have loved me really unconditionally. As I look back over my life, I realize that their love for me was certainly a very powerful sign of God's love for me. Again, I don't, when I was young, I don't think I had any clue about that, but the experience of it certainly was that. So, so it it was a natural step for me, maybe I could say it that way, in terms of faith, to place my confidence in God, to have faith in God's love. I could fairly easily make that step because I felt so loved and had a place of confidence in my my mom and my dad. So I think about that often now, as a, especially as we all grow older, as they grow older, as I grow older, and I'm profoundly grateful for that.
Wow. My grandmother used to talk about a memory when she was young, very, very young, an experience of, it was very simple, actually. She was pushing a baby carriage. She was about 5 years old, pushing a baby carriage with a little doll in it. But it was in the sunshine. It was after a long winter. And her mother, very tenderly, with a lot of extra attention and love, brought this baby carriage out for her and said, all right, you can go out and play. And she can remember every detail of the sun warming her. And she described it years later to her brother, who was a Jesuit priest, and said, you know, Thomas, I just can't get this moment out of my mind, how happy I was. Winter was over. It was the first day of spring, the sun. My mom had taken all this care. And he said, you know what that was? That was God loving you. That was an experience of God loving you. And she said it changed the way she saw her whole life. I pointed out to her that she then became a mother of six children and always, and then a grandmother and a great grandmother. And she loved children. And so in a way that, that I guess thinking like a poet symbolically, her pushing the baby carriage was a foreshadowing of how she would welcome children her whole life. God loving her through what would be her vocation, really.
Absolutely.
Is there a moment when you were little where, you know, a few of us remember, you know that at the time, but where you say, wow, maybe when it was when I was riding my bike or when you just felt God's love? Did you have a, an experience like that, perhaps?
My family's tradition for our vacations when I was a kid, so beginning when I was, I think, maybe around 10 years old and then extending through my teen years, was to go camping in the summers.
Oh, wow.
And I can recall being with my family in the Great Smoky Mountains and just being overwhelmed with the beauty of everything that was around me and feeling so deeply loved by God and so much a part of the creation that I was surrounded by. So that that's a memory that comes back to me frequently enough when I think about those family vacations and whenever I see or experience another moment of God's beauty and creation.
That's wonderful. What was a day you remember or like a pivotal maybe season of your life or time that was transformative for you in whether it was strengthening or renewing your fervor and faith in God?
So back in 2011, I had the great privilege of walking the Camino de Santiago in northern Spain to visit the city of Santiago de Compostela, where the remains of St. James are revered. And I was, at that time, I was a parish priest, as I am now. I had been in a parish for 8 years as a pastor. And I was very happy in that ministry, as I am very happy in my ministry now. So it wasn't as if I were in any way growing weary of that ministry.
Sure.
But the experience of the Camino and of experiencing the inspiration that I found in that journey, in being inspired by fellow pilgrims, being inspired by those who helped me along the way in various ways, and being inspired by the fact that I was taking part in something that had been that has been a part of the church's experience for centuries now.
Yes,
I found my faith strengthened and my my energy renewed, and perhaps it all got crystallized for a moment. It got crystallized in many moments of that journey, but as you may know, Annabelle, when you arrive at Santiago de Compostela, one of the things that you are invited to do as a pilgrim having completed, or as anyone visiting the cathedral there, is invited to do that. There's a statue of James that sort of sits above the sanctuary, one is able to climb up behind him on a stairway and embrace that statue.
That's beautiful.
Oh, it's a wonderful experience, you're with others who have come to the church either as pilgrims or have come to visit the church in prayer, and you're making your way up. But I can remember feeling myself almost overwhelmed by the sense that perhaps millions before me had walked up those stairs and had embraced that statue, and I felt myself just a part of this wonderful life journey, faith journey that we're so privileged to be on.
This sacred embrace. That's so powerful. Wow. That pilgrimage? Did that take a long time?
I walked for 31 days.
Wow.
Yes. So,
the longest possible month.
Yes. Yes.
Wow. When did you take the pilgrimage? What time of year?
It was February. I began in February of 2011.
Wow.
As it happened, I began on the Feast of Our Lady of Lourdes. I wish I could tell you that I planned that deliberately, but I did not. It worked out calendar-wise, but I was delighted that it did work out that way.
Yeah.
So I began on February 11th, and I arrived 31 days later in Santiago de Compostela. Yes, so it was an extraordinary experience.
That's amazing. Just thinking of this question, St. John of the Cross wrote of being with Jesus in times of solitude. He's known for that. And he actually wrote about those times of quiet, of even darkness, of even night. He writes eloquently of sometimes that night is his friend because all else is still. Everything else, all the other responsibilities or distractions will fade away for him. And he could just be alone with God and delight in that. You're a very busy pastor. Where do you go to steal away to Jesus? Quoting that great song, Steal Away. Mm-hmm. But what are those moments like for you? For example, a place, a time of day? When do you find that spiritual solitude, or where?
Yes, for years now, I've grown accustomed to, and I look forward to getting up rather early in the morning. So I try to get up between 5 and 5:15. And that early morning is just a time of great peace and comfort for me, similar to John of the Cross, to be especially at the times of the year when it remains dark, well into the morning. I don't find the darkness intimidating at all. I find it a place of great peace and calm and quiet, and that I feel that a connection to God. So my very favorite time is that time of the day to have that experience of quiet and solitude. And I feel that it's a way for me to connect once again with my relationship with the Lord, and then to welcome the fact that will, I hope, steer me well through the day that lies ahead. So it's that's certainly for me that place of finding that quiet solitude, and I cherish that.
You know, that's a great reminder to our listeners who go through periods, we all do, right, of just feeling so busy. And how do you make that time to be alone in prayer with the Lord? It's also a great parental reminder. you know, you as a pastor have all these fatherly responsibilities. I know sometimes as parents with little children who wake up pretty early,
yes,
and then keep you busy all day. Yours is a wonderful fatherly reminder to say, okay, there'll be a lot of people who'll need you all day, but to restore yourself at the beginning of it, set the clock earlier and make that time when you can, because it really is. I know the times I'm able to do something like that, it really does change the shape of the day.
Oh, I find that all the time, Annabelle. Yes, right. That on those times that I'm not able to do that for one reason or another,
sure.
I notice halfway through the day, I notice that there is certainly a difference.
Right. That's such a great reminder. Thank you. And how would you, I just wanted to ask you this question. Obviously, you know, your vocation is something discussed a lot around priesthood and priests, your vocation. But how would you articulate your vocation? Perhaps your particular charism within being a priest, or what you feel called to do as a priest. It's something I'm asking everyone I interview. Mm-hmm. How would you articulate your vocation, and how have you, you know, sort of hope or see that it could influence others?
Mm. If I may, I'll go back to the experience of the Camino and
yes,
speak about it as I see my vocation as being a part of that great journey that I have the privilege of being on the way, on the Camino with my brothers and sisters in Christ. And so predominantly for all of us is that the grace of our baptism, that we are aware of the fact that we are God's beloved daughters and sons, and on the journey into what that means, and allowing that reality to shape and form our lives, and that we do it together. We're on the road together, walking together, and that added to that, I've the privilege of having been called to exercise leadership in whatever ways that I possibly can, but I always think about that in terms of our being on the journey together. So that one of the things that Pope Francis has said that strikes me so strongly is the image, of course, of the shepherd with those entrusted to the shepherd's care, and that it's it's sometimes a matter of the shepherd being walking out a little bit in front, but other times it's a matter of the shepherd walking in the midst of. Mm. At other times it's a matter of the shepherd walking behind so as to be sure that no one gets left behind or lost.
Yeah.
So I think of my priestly vocation in that kind of way.
That's so inspiring. It reminds me, one of my favorite spiritual books. I loved A Shepherd Looks at Psalm 23.
Mm.
And really reading for the first time, you know, because here we are in contemporary society, we don't see shepherds every day the way in Jesus's time people knew what shepherds did. Really, really knew.
Yes.
How they stayed awake with their flock, how they would, you know, go out of their way if they were a good shepherd to rescue the lamb. And reading that really made a huge impression on me with what it really means to be a shepherd.
Mm.
Symbolically, and then you're living it as a priest. How would you say your priesthood has influenced your faith, or your vocation has influenced your faith? When I have folks on who are, let's say, whether they're a teacher or an attorney, you know, they'll talk about how what they do every day has impacted their faith. Maybe the attorney will have a greater cry for justice, but wants to balance that with peace, the more they see of the court system, for example. Or a teacher might say, well, I spend my life working with students, and that has impacted me because the students then shape me in turn. I think every listener would be fascinated to know, you know, how has your priesthood, your vocation, influenced your own personal faith journey?
One of the things I think of immediately is having the privilege, because it's certainly that, of leading the community in prayer at the celebration of liturgies of all kinds,
yeah.
Certainly the liturgy of the Eucharist, and of being aware of the fact that we are all being called, as did Jesus, to give ourselves for the sake of one another. And as the one who has the privilege of praying that prayer in the name of the community or leading the community in that prayer.
Yes.
I feel that I'm very much shaped by that. Also, one of the things that strikes me again and again, and I remember hearing this from a priest on the faculty of the seminary where I studied for priestly ministry.
Oh, wow.
He commented on the fact that it was his experience that almost always, if not always, when he preached, he was preaching first to himself, and then speaking, he hoped, in ways that would be helpful to those listening. And I've certainly found that to be true in all of the years that I've had the privilege of preaching. I know that I'm often speaking to myself, calling myself forward, or challenging myself to recognize what has been put before us in these particular scripture texts of the day. So certainly the privilege of preaching has shaped my faith and shaped my spiritual journey very, very strongly.
That is so beautiful. Thank you. Feel so blessed, Father Bob, to have you on this particular episode of Destination Sainthood, which is a special Thanksgiving. We're getting ready for Thanksgiving, celebrating Thanksgiving. I hope people will replay it as a podcast for years to come on Thanksgiving. It can be listened to really any time, but the fact that we're recording this kind of getting ready for Thanksgiving, what I think is so special, having chosen to have you on the show this week of all weeks, is that, of course, Thanksgiving, we think of as Catholics, the word Eucharist means Thanksgiving. And so we are a Eucharistic people. We center our lives around the Eucharist. And to have you here reminding us of the importance of the Eucharist, I just think it couldn't be more special for our listeners. Can you give us a little bit of just your thoughts on what could make Thanksgiving extra special for us as Catholics?
Mm. Well, thanks, Annabelle. I'm so grateful you asked that question because it made me think about the fact that it's very striking to me that for us in our Catholic calendar, we begin the month of November, which I think is in many ways a month of Thanksgiving in for all of us, in,
yes.
no matter our faith tradition.
Certainly.
But we begin the month of Thanksgiving with the recollection of all of the great saints who have gone before us, the very first day of the month, given over to that, of all of our beloved dead, as you said so beautifully before, those who are saints who have gone before us, who may not be officially named so, but we know that they indeed lived great lives of great holiness, so all of the beloved gone before us. So right at the beginning of the month, as Catholics, we're invited to be awash in all of these great gifts that God has given us, these wonderful men and women who have given us great example and continue to inspire us and encourage us. So I think there's that element of the way in which the Catholic mind enters into the month of November.
Yes.
And then, of course, as you said so well, our Eucharistic celebrations are always praise and thanks to God for all that God has done and will continue to do for us. So as we make our way through the month, we just have all of these ways in which we can prepare then to celebrate at the end of the month the great feast of Thanksgiving and gather up all of those things into that feast and be mindful of how greatly blessed we are by God.
Wow, how wonderfully said. And as we get ready, any moment really, right after Thanksgiving, Advent comes in. Could you maybe offer any brief advice to listeners for just making this Advent or any Advent meaningful, extra meaningful?
One of the great antiphons, or I think it also takes the form of a hymn, I'm pretty sure it does, in the Advent season is, "For you, O Lord, my soul in stillness waits." And I think Advent has that here in our northern hemisphere, has that characteristic of stillness as the weather turns and the earth becomes more still, and as the darkness gathers, there's a stillness that comes with the very environment in which we're living. And then I think it's an invitation to us, with all of our lives being so busy with many good, essential, and important things. It's also an invitation. I know I feel an invitation to me. The season calls me to that stillness, that being more quiet and listening for all of the ways in which God is continuing to enter into our experience as we prepare to celebrate the great entry of God into the human experience in the Feast of Christmas. And one of the things I find is a good way to challenge myself, and perhaps it's a good way that we could all challenge ourselves, would be living as we do in an environment that has so much information coming at us from sources,
yes.
And particularly our electronic devices. So right. Maybe it would be helpful to all of us if we could unplug a bit here and there along the way during the Advent season, however that might work its way out in each of our lives,
right.
To at least make a conscious effort to step away from that very busy world in which we live so that we can wait in stillness for the ways in which the Lord will be coming to us.
Powerful advice for making this Advent more meaningful. Thank you so much, Father Bob, for joining us here on Destination Sainthood. We really feel truly blessed to have your words of wisdom.
And thank you so much, Annabelle, for the opportunity and for the example that you offer to me, for the ways in which you live your faith with your husband Mark and your family, and that's a great inspiration to me. So thank you so much.
Thank you. Father Bob, I wonder if you could offer a prayer to anyone listening, just a sort of a blessing or prayer for our listeners to going forth on their own journey, as you so aptly described, the journey that we're all on, the pilgrimage, really, of faith. Would you offer a prayer for our listeners?
I'd be happy to. Holy and loving God, we bless and praise you for all of your many good gifts that you give us in such great abundance. We bless and praise you for the gift of calling us into life and for calling us into this journey of faith. We bless and praise you for the gift of those who accompany us, our sisters and brothers in faith, and all who walk with us on life's journey. We bless you for those who have inspired us, who love us, who encourage us, who help us in our times of need, who help to heal our wounds. We ask blessing upon all of those with whom we journey. Help us to grow strong together so that we may continue this journey into the eternal life that you promise. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Amen. If you would remember us in prayer, Father Bob, here at Destination Sainthood, that we may live that prayer. Thank you so much.
You're most welcome.
Let us reflect on our blessings, on all we are thankful for, as we listen to Doxology, sung by Heidi Nadine, flowing right into John Becker's version of The Litany of the Saints. After all, November began with the Feast of All Saints, and as the month closes with the great holiday of gratitude, we remember and cherish those we have loved who have gone before us to be with the Lord. We call upon the saints and ask their intercession in our lives. We purpose to generously love those who are still this side of heaven. We aim to work in the ways we can for God's kingdom, and we count our blessings. Happy Thanksgiving, God's beloved.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Praise the Father, praise the Son, praise the Holy Ghost. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly Father, Son, and Holy.
mercy on us, sinners.
Following the words of Hebrews 12:1, therefore, since we are surrounded by such a great cloud of witnesses, let us throw off everything that hinders and the sin that so easily entangles, and let us run with endurance the race set out for us. Let us fix our eyes on Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who, for the joy set before him, endured the cross, scorning its shame, and sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. God bless you, dear listeners. May we follow and someday join the great cloud of witnesses.
Must